This video is brought to you by language. Literally. It's what I'm using right now to transmit information to you. Language is one of the fundamental, uniquely human things about us. But where did it come from? Language doesn't exactly fossilize, so to answer that, we have to look at it like any other biological trait to try to determine how it evolved. Here's just a few of the ways scientists have tried to talk it out. Figuring out when we developed language is really important for a lot of reasons. For starters, plenty of anthropologists and linguists think language was one of the key factors that allowed modern humans to develop complex societies and other behaviors that make us unique. It's a linchpin in social interaction, sharing information, formulating worldviews, and developing cultural ideas like myths. But like all big questions in research, this one has proved to be contentious. So much so that in the 1860s, the Linguistic Society of Paris forbade its members from discussing the origin of language at all. And a few years later, the equivalent British group followed suit. They may have been worried that these contentious discussions could lead to researchers exchanging more than just words. And while at least researchers are able to study it now, there's still a lot of debate. But if we're going to talk about when language evolved, first we have to define what language is. More specifically, we need to define what makes human language different from the ways that other animals communicate. Bees do dances to tell their coworkers where food is, prairie dogs have different alarm calls to warn of different predators, and a parrot named Alex reportedly had a vocabulary of over 100 words that he was able to use to identify things and answer questions. But there's a lot more to a language than that. While there are differences of opinion over the best definition of a language, one of the features that mostly everyone thinks a language needs is recursion, or being able to embed one piece of grammar in another of the same type. For example, in the sentence, "Becca told me that Russell baked cookies," the words "Russell baked cookies" could function as a whole sentence on their own, but by putting them inside another sentence, we have a new idea that we couldn't have had without that recursion. Being able to stack phrases like this allows us to create an essentially infinite number of sentences. We can do this and understand people when they do it, because language has syntax, or rules that determine how pieces and parts are put together for specific meanings. So language requires two skills: the cognitive ability to understand these recursions and the physical ability to express them, which brings us to the question of how we got those skills. There are two basic ideas, both of which have their supporters and detractors. The first is that language is so complex that it had to develop in teeny tiny increments over a super long period of time. In this version, language and our cognitive skills co-evolved, with natural selection acting on a series of pre-language traits, eventually evolving into a fully fledged language. That could have looked like having a small vocabulary of individual word sounds, then combining two words together to mean something new, then eventually developing syntax and recursion and language at the same time. Baby steps. The other idea is that the evolution of language happened a lot faster, and we basically went from no language to language all at once. In this scenario, natural selection would have worked with traits that had nothing to do with language. So maybe our brain size evolved because it favored toolmaking, and our inner ears evolved to be extra sensitive to the pitches most common in nature. And once we had evolved all of those physical and cognitive traits for other purposes, all it took were tiny tweaks to put all those together and make a language. And to figure out which of these hypotheses is correct, we have to turn to physical evidence to let us peek into evolutionary history, which is really squishy because language itself doesn't leave much evidence behind. Sure, there's writing, and the oldest example of that is Mesopotamian cuneiform, which is about 5,000 years old. But we're pretty sure that language has to be older than writing itself, and probably by a long shot, because many of the things that humans have done just wouldn't be possible without a way to communicate big ideas. Like, how do you tell another person how to build a structure without words? So we have to look for indirect evidence of language that predates the written word. Language isn't really possible without symbols and the cognitive ability to process them. A word can represent an object, but it's not the object itself. This kind of symbolic representation means that language lets us talk about things that aren't directly in front of us, plus abstract ideas or concepts like fear or love or extinction. And because these things aren't exact representations of concepts, there needs to be some way of ensuring that everybody knows what a specific symbol represents. They would have had to talk about it. So if we look for evidence of symbolic thought, We can assume they also had language. Mesopotamian cuneiform developed out of a system of physical tokens, which were used by merchants to keep track of merchandise. Each different type of token corresponded to a specific item, like a jar of oil or a basket of grain. That's symbolic representation. So we can say that people had to have used language as long ago as the oldest of these tokens existed, which was 10,000 years ago. But that's where our ability to directly translate symbols pretty much ends. Before that, we have things that we believe are linked to symbolic thought, but we don't necessarily know what the symbols represent. There's plenty of examples of objects that had no literal utilitarian function, but we still find them in places where humans hung out. There are these geometric patterns at a site called Blombos Cave in South Africa, which are 75,000 years old. A similar decorative pattern is found over and over again at that site, suggesting that it meant something to the people etching it. And in Morocco, researchers have found shells with little holes drilled into them that are 82,000 years old. The holes suggest the shells were worn as beads, or ornamentation. Unfortunately, those are pretty much the oldest physical artifacts of symbolic thought that researchers can agree on, and the evidence going further back just gets murkier. Like, there's this pigment made from clay called ochre, which had functional uses, but could also have been used to color things for symbolic reasons. Archaeologists have found flakes of pigment in layers of dirt dating back as far as 400,000 years ago, but it's tough to say which things were colored for functional purposes and which of them were symbolic. That's about as far as we can get with just looking at stuff. So now, let's turn to the evidence we get from language users and talk about anatomy. But before we get into that, we're gonna use our language skills on a quick ad.
This SciShow video is supported by Jump, a statistical analysis software designed to help you with all of your analytics needs. If you're working with a dataset that has what feels like way too many variables, you could use Jump's predictor screening to highlight the most meaningful variables and avoid wasting your energy on the other ones. You could also untangle which of those variables have the biggest impact on your dataset using Jump's multivariate approaches. Principal components analysis and partial least squares regression sort out those questions for you. There's no need to struggle through data that you can't make heads or tails of. Jump is here to help. And you can test it out with a 30-day free trial for anyone, anywhere at jmp.com/scishow.
Most of the languages in the world are spoken out loud, and speaking requires breath control, and that requires fine control of the muscles from a bunch of nerves. Fossilized remains show that the duct that those nerves pass through is much larger in Homo sapiens and Neanderthals than it is in earlier species, suggesting that early humans and Neanderthals had greater control of their lungs and were better equipped to produce speech. The vocal tract is also critical for speech. The human vocal tract includes our voice box that's about halfway down the throat, the sinuses and palate, and our round tongue. And the location of that voice box raises some evolutionary questions, because while that's good for speech, it's also bad if you don't want to die from choking. Being able to produce sounds isn't enough, though. You also need others to be able to hear those sounds. So some archaeologists have looked at the bones of the inner ear that let us hear. These bones are tiny, so they can be hard to recover. But fortunately, newer discoveries of well-preserved ear bones give us a peek at how they've changed through time. Modern humans have ear bones that are especially sensitive to the frequency range of human speech, which suggests that they were adapted to listening to others talk. But there's also evidence that Neanderthals had those same changes to the throat and ears, which has two tantalizing explanations. Either Neanderthals independently evolved the ability to chit-chat with their neighbors, or that our ancestors were ready to talk and listen before our two lineages split apart, which was over 400,000 years ago. So physically, most of the requirements for speech production were in place by that time. That's all on the production part of language, or at least speech. But you don't necessarily need speech for language. Gestures and sign languages are just as linguistically complex as spoken ones, and would have required a lot of brain power to use, which means that the evidence for ear and throat changes might not be able to tell us the furthest possible origin date for language. But what we can look at is brains, or the closest thing to them that we get in the fossil record. Endocasts are fossilized impressions of the inside of the skull, which let researchers study the shape of various regions of a brain even when that brain has long since decayed away. They're not perfect, since they can't really tell us how specific neurons connected with each other, or sent signals, or what the structures on the inside of the brain looked like. But they are a starting point. Some researchers have considered brain volume when looking for signs of language capacity. If we assume there's some minimum size threshold for language, we have to assume that we meet it. So if a species had brains that were the same size as ours, We could say it was possible they used language too. That keeps Neanderthals in the running, but it also means that an even older hominin, like Homo erectus, could have gossiped around the campfire as far back as 2 million years ago, even if they were using more of a gestured language to do so. It's important to note two things here. First, brain volume doesn't totally correlate with intelligence. And second, being really intelligent doesn't necessarily mean you have language. That's a specific type of smarts. So instead of looking at the whole brain, other research has focused on areas that we know are needed for language in modern humans. Fortunately, two of the most famous language areas in modern humans, Wernicke's area and Broca's area, are right on the surface of the brain, so we can see them on endocasts. Looking at our extended family, regions that are physically similar to these two areas show up in great apes and baboons, which suggests that this particular feature was actually present before apes and old world monkeys split off from each other, somewhere in the range of 20 to 30 million years. But those species don't have the ability to use their own languages, so obviously, those other animals aren't using them for speech. So it's likely that they evolved for other purposes and then at some point got reassigned. In apes, these areas may be related to gesturing and vocalizations, forms of communication, but not language. So that's score one for the language was a byproduct of evolution of unrelated traits, folks I mentioned earlier. At this point, we've narrowed the development of language down to somewhere between 2 million years ago when brains evolved to be at least as big as ours, and 82,000 years ago when ornamental beads show up. Which, it's not nothing, but it's such a big time span that it doesn't really tell us much. Fortunately, there's another area to explore. Genetics. Researchers have identified a gene that appears to code for some aspects of vocal production and learning in a bunch of vertebrate species. For instance, we have a mutation in a speech-related gene called FOXP2 that sets us apart from other living species. But this same mutation was also present in Neanderthals, meaning that it's at least 400,000 years old. But the mutation alone doesn't tell us anything about the cognitive aspects of language, since it's more about vocalizing than it is about grammar. So instead of looking for relationships between genes and a specific behavior, in 2025, an international team of researchers decided to look at the genetic relationships between groups of early people. And instead of using archaeological evidence to try to pinpoint when language developed, they used migration. As I've mentioned, language is uniquely human, which means, outside of some very specific circumstances with individuals who have cognitive or physical differences, language is something that all humans have an innate ability to use. Every single human community on Earth has a language, and some have multiple. That's more than 7,000 languages with complex rules for how words, sentences, and meanings are constructed. This suggests that language, or at least the capacity for it, developed back when Homo sapiens were living in close quarters, before we started migrating out of Africa. All modern humans are descended from those different waves of migrants, so all the traits that we have in common across the whole species most likely existed before we left Africa. Researchers are pretty sure that the first group of people to separate from the rest of Homo sapiens were the ancestors of the Khoisan people found in southern Africa. Genomic data allows us to estimate when they split from the rest of the population by looking at DNA and identifying the places where there are differences from other groups of people. See, mutations in DNA happen at a pretty consistent rate, so by comparing how many have built up between two groups, scientists can estimate how long ago the group separated. And that let the researchers estimate that the separation happened roughly 135,000 years ago. Now, this doesn't mean that language evolved 135,000 years ago. It means that the capacity for language was in place by then. We don't have a ton of evidence of symbolic behavior that suggests we were actually using language at that point, and we won't confidently see that for at least another 50,000 years. So one possibility is that our ancestors evolved the physical structures for language back before Homo sapiens and Neanderthals split apart. Those cognitive skills continued to develop in the Homo sapiens lineage, and we had basically the full toolbox by the time some of us hit the road to the rest of the world. And then somewhere around 80,000 years ago, we put it all together and boom, language and modern human behavior. But that's just one idea of what might have happened. So while we may never know exactly when our ancestors acquired the gift of yapping, that won't stop us from talking about it.